먼저 소개를 올리겠습니다. KT 맥팔랜드 전 국가안보부 보좌관은 전 폭스뉴스 국가안보 분석가로 활동을 했습니다. 1978년 옥스퍼드 대학에서 학사, 석사 학위를 받았고 미국 MIT에서 박사 과정을 수료했습니다. 주요 관심사는 핵무기와 중국, 소련입니다. 맥팔랜드는 리차드 닉슨 행정부와 제럴드 포드 행정부 시절에 보좌관을 역임했고 로널드 레이건 행정부에서는 국방부 공공지원 차관 보호를 역임했습니다. 이런 공로로 지난 1985년에는 국방 공로 훈장도 받았습니다. 오늘은 지정학이라는 제목의 발표를 통해서 중국의 야심이 한반도와 세계에 미치는 영향에 대해서 발표해 주겠습니다. 마이크를 워싱턴 DC로 넘깁니다.
Thank you very much, Mr. Min, and I bring greetings to all of my friends in Seoul. When we met a year ago, you know, we talked about the importance of freedom and democracies in our own society and all the good things we were going to do together. And, you know, in a certain way, it seemed almost like an academic exercise when we look at it from today, a year later. Because here we are, we're under global lockdown, global pandemic, global recession. We're coming to each other from all over the world. I'm in my living room right now in Long Island. I know others are in Washington, D.C., others are in Seoul, others in Hawaii, others in San Francisco. And today, as we meet, it really takes on this really struggle we were talking about between freedom and democracy on one hand and authoritarian, communist, socialist governments on the other. It has become very real. And we are now really in the struggle of our lives. A few months ago, when we were talking about what would happen to KCPEC this year, you know, people said, well, it's going to be too hard. We have travel bans. People can't leave their countries. They can't come back to their countries. It's going to be too complicated. Nobody will want to come. And you know, the great thing, though, about conservatives and my fellow conservatives is people said, well, we're not going to let that stop us. We really believe in this. And so individuals step forward. I really have to thank Annie Chan for really making KCPEC 2020 possible, because without her support, this may never have happened. The other thing about conservatives, though, is we're playing the long game. We understand that we've got to win the arguments, and we have to tell our own people and to tell ourselves that this is a struggle worth having. And that's why I am so proud of the affiliation that we've had with One Korea Network, with the New Institute, and with the people at KCPEC. You're real freedom fighters. And I'm particularly honored to be associated with the American Conservative Union, America CPAC, and the chairman, Matt Schlapp, and President Dan Schneider, because they have, in the last decade, they've brought the conservative message all around the United States. And now, with Korea and Japan and Australia and other countries, we're bringing the conservative message all around the world. And it has never been more essential than it is today, because the struggle today, how we deal with these issues today, especially in Asia, and especially in Northeast Asia, will determine our futures, and not just for another couple of years, but a couple of decades. This is the struggle of our lives, and it's between democracy and communism. It's between free nations and totalitarian nations. You know, a year ago, President Trump, or at the beginning of the Trump administration, he was cautiously optimistic that we would find a good relationship with China. And we had a trade war with the idea that we would have trade negotiations and that we would find a way in a phase one and then a phase two trade agreement to have reciprocal tariffs. When we started out, the Chinese and other countries had tariffs up here on American goods, and our tariffs on their goods were down here. And President Trump used the tariffs and used a trade war to say, okay, let's all get at the same level and then have reciprocity and come down. He also approached a lot of our allies in Europe and in Asia and even in North America to say, let's really up our contribution to our common defense and our commitment to freedom. And that's where we were a year ago. And it looked like things would go well. But the pandemic changed everything. Now, I can't speak for President Trump today. I'm not part of the administration, although I remain close to him and a lot of the senior officials in the Trump administration. And I was part of the group that set up our policy from the very beginning. So I know what the thinking is, and I can relay to you that the attitude has changed. The attitude in the United States has changed. Because with the pandemic, however the virus started, whether it was in a wet lab in Wuhan, or in a wet market in Wuhan, or it was in a virology lab in Wuhan, however it started didn't matter, because it's what the Chinese did with it then. The Chinese, when they realized, when their scientists and doctors realized the potential for lethality in a pandemic, instead of sharing that information with the world so that we could all take precautions and save our own people and our own societies, they covered it up. The scientists and the doctors, this research that they had done, it disappeared. They disappeared. A number of them disappeared. And what the Chinese government did at that point was that they prohibited travel between Wuhan and the rest of China, and knowing the potential for a pandemic. And yet they allowed travel to go from Wuhan to the rest of the world. Chinese from Wuhan went to Korea. They went to Europe. They went to the United States. They went all over the world spreading the pandemic. And so the Chinese government, the totalitarian communist Chinese government, they used the pandemic as they used the coronavirus or COVID-19 as a biological weapon. And that's where we are today. They didn't warn the world. They let it spread. They encouraged the spread. And then while they were assuring us there was really nothing to this, it wasn't spreading, they sort of lulled us into inaction. The Chinese government then cornered the market on medicines, on testing equipment, and personal protective devices. So they then could decide who got those life-saving technologies and equipment. And if a country dared criticize China, I mean, the European governments tried to criticize China, and the Chinese went to them and said, you criticize us, and we're not letting you have the PPE, we're not letting you have the testing. They came to the White House, and they said to President Trump, if you criticize our behavior, if you blame us for any of this, we're going to cut off your supplies of penicillin, amoxicillin, and acetaminophen. They went to the Australians, and they had said to the Australians, if you dare join 100 other nations and ask for some kind of an investigation into the origins of the coronavirus, we're going to shut off our imports of your beef and your barley. We're going to cripple your economic agricultural economy. So the Chinese have played tough throughout this period. And then they also have used the cover of the pandemic to do things in Hong Kong. For example, they told the people in Hong Kong, two systems, one China. You can have your own government, you can have your own laws, and yet they reversed that. Under the guise of the pandemic, thinking that the world wasn't going to notice, they have a national security law which prohibits any Chinese anywhere in the world from criticizing or demonstrating against their government. And the penalty, life imprisonment. They also are now buying up at fire sale prices technology companies in the West and in Asia, as well as resource companies around the world. So the Chinese have used this period of a global pandemic, a period of economic and political division and dislocation throughout the world, and the lockdown, to do what they had intended to take 50 years to do. We always knew that China wanted to dominate the world by mid-century. They made no secret of it. They wanted to dominate a trade route, a maritime trade route that would go from Europe and the Middle East and East Africa through the South China Sea and East China Sea to Asia. They wanted to control, and they still want to control, the South China Sea. They want to treat it as an internal Chinese lake. They're also creating a land-based trade route to link Europe, the Middle East, and Asia, called One Belt, One Road. In addition to that, they plan to dominate the communications of the future, and they're trying to build the internet infrastructure of the future. And Gordon Chang and others mentioned earlier 5G. They want to use 5G, and in particular their company Huawei, to really dominate our ability to communicate with each other, and in the case of Korea, probably interfere with your elections. And then finally, they have a plan to take, they call it the commanding heights of technology. It's called Made in China 2025. They plan to dominate the 10 technologies of the future, artificial intelligence, bioengineering, and the whole range of technologies that they realize that they are not ahead in, but they want to be ahead, and they will buy it, they will borrow it, they will steal it. They want to command and control these technologies because they feel that if they control maritime trade, if they control land-based trade routes, if they control communications trade routes, and they control technology, they really control the world. And then they will rewrite the rules of order, as they say, with Chinese characteristics. Now, they've made no secret of that ambition, but what they have done under the guise of the pandemic is to speed up that timeline. They plan to emerge in the next several years, emerge from this pandemic period as the dominant largest economy, as the country which tells everybody else what to do. Now, the Chinese will say, well, we don't conquer nations. We're not an expansionist power. And that may be true, but they plan to control nations. And they plan to take our democratic freedoms, and they plan to crush them from within. They plan to use our institutions of free elections and freedom of speech, and they plan to turn us against each other. What they've done, in not only in Hong Kong, but in their wolf warrior diplomacy, is they have treated the world as if we really don't matter as much as China does. And they talk openly about the kind of world they envision, which is not one that respects the rule of law. It is not one that respects the freedom and freedom of choice and freedom of decisions of other nations. When they, when China has moved into the South China Sea and with their One Belt, One Road, they've made it very clear that nothing is going to stand in their way. The thing is, we in the West, we the United States in particular, we thought China would take the same path that Korea took and Japan took and other countries took. We assumed that if we helped the Chinese develop, if we underwrote and subsidized their economic developments, that as they modernized, they would become a more open society and a more open economy, just like Japan has become, just like Korea has become. And we thought they would be our trading partners, competitors, yes, but we would all be playing by the same rules of international order. And what we have seen in the, particularly with the pandemic, where they've taken the gloves off, we now see what they're doing. And we have concluded, we in the Trump administration, we in both political parties in the United States, that the time has come for a very different approach to China and really to our allies. In a series of four speeches in the last 2 months, senior officials of the Trump administration laid out the case against China. They laid out the case of Chinese intellectual property theft, of Chinese wolf warrior diplomacy, of Chinese military aggression in the South China and East China Seas. And what they also did, and what President Trump, in fact, is announcing as we're meeting now, he's announcing this at the Republican convention, is a different approach. America has now a very different attitude towards China and a very different attitude towards our countries, our allies. And here's how it will play out. There are three parts to this new program. The first is to bring our supply chains home. We have always, we the United States, have always wanted and have always insisted that the technologies we need for our national security, our weapon systems, our computer systems, be made in America so we would be self-reliant. What we never thought we would have to do is say, well, our pharmaceutical chains, supply chains, also we need to be self-sufficient. So we are going to bring the supply chains back to America and to our trusted allies, countries like Korea, countries like Britain. We can trust each other, but we cannot trust the Chinese, as they have already shown in the last several months. The second thing we're doing is we are going to our allies, our traditional allies, and we are saying to them, let us stand together. Each one of our countries has been affected by Chinese wolf warrior diplomacy, by the Chinese using the Wuhan virus as a bioweapon. And so we would stand together. That's why the meetings that President Trump and the administration have had with the Brits, with the Germans, with the Europeans, with the Japanese, with the Koreans, and others, we hope to form a coalition of the 10 largest economies and democracies So we stand together. Now, we would stand together to go to China and say, look, we don't want to stop you. We don't want to suppress you. We want you to just play fair. We want you to play by the international rules that we have all respected as our countries have changed and evolved and modernized. And if we go to China together as a bloc, then we feel that the Chinese will really be in a far better position, because their intention is to pick us off one at a time when we're each is smaller. But once we stand together, then we'll be in a much stronger position. And what President Trump is going to announce this week is something called decoupling, that if the Chinese government does not want to do this, if they refuse to have equal opportunities to invest in each other's countries, equal trade relations, equal tariffs, equal respect for international law, respect for the maritime trade routes that all of our countries have enjoyed for decades, then we could decouple our economies. Now, we wouldn't completely decouple, but in those areas that I've mentioned, which are essential for our national security, we would act as a trading bloc of Western and Eastern democracies and free market systems. The final thing that President Trump has already announced and will continue in a second term particularly is to reinvest in our technology. You know, I think as Americans, we kind of admit we got a little lazy. We always assumed that we would be the technology leaders of the world. And we have not invested as we should in some of the technologies, particularly in 5G. But we are now doubling down. We are reinvesting. We've increased investment in artificial intelligence in the last couple of months. We've doubled our investment in artificial intelligence, and we will do that with other technologies as well. And once we regain the commanding heights of technology, we will protect our intellectual property rights. We will not let it be stolen. We will not let it be sold. We will not let other countries, but particularly in this case, China, exploit us. I think it's important, though, to talk a little bit about what the Chinese are doing and how our systems are so different. You know, an authoritarian government, a dictatorship, a totalitarian nation, the leaders of that country, they think, well, just because they can tell their own people what to do, they don't have to answer to their own people. They think, well, maybe they can treat the rest of the world like that. We have an expression in the United States, and I think it probably comes from poker, but it's an expression that says you overplay your hand. The Chinese are overplaying their hand right now. They have become far too smug and self-confident that they know that the future is the 21st century is Chinese and America and Japan and Korea and other nations in the region as well as abroad, outside of the region, will just become Chinese vassals like the good old days of 2,000 years ago. But I think what's happened in the last couple of weeks and months is that the countries who have been so imposed upon and exploited by the Chinese in this tragic era, they have now come to realize that, well, maybe we need to all stand up together. I also think it's worth noting that in democracies, yours, mine, democracies, the people tend not to jump ahead. They tend to not take action swiftly or rapidly. They tend to really, because we're happy with our lives. We're happy with the governments that we create. And yet, once things get to the point where we realize what's happened, we democracies, we people, we the people in our democracies, we stand up and we say, enough. And I think that's where we are now. And so what Korea has experienced with election fraud and Chinese involvement and you're trying to interfere with your elections and the prospects that they are going to try to interfere with our elections, it has given us all common cause to work together. So my wish for the future is that the Koreans and the Americans, we can meet again in Seoul next year in 2021, and we will be united in our common purpose. And our common purpose is to guarantee the peace and prosperity of our people. And understand that we may not have volunteered to be freedom fighters, but we are. And that this is the most important struggle of all of our lives, because if we don't succeed, then our children and our children's children, they won't enjoy the freedom to make their own decisions, to make their own mistakes even, And they will live in a very different world than the one that we've enjoyed for the last, well, probably 70 or so years. So I'd like to conclude by thanking you for everyone for having this very different conference and a very different opportunity to talk to each other, but to really applaud you for soldiering on and for joining us together across oceans and half a world away to make common cause for freedom. Thank you.